thing with keyboards is just hit those buttons, they pick up on you. Well, for those of you that need a Bible to follow along with this morning, just raise your hand and maybe Mr. Gray could grab a Bible, get some Bibles. Or Miss Anna. Miss Anna's back here, she grabs them. Gray. Anybody need a Bible to follow along with this morning? This is bad. Guess we don't need them. These are Bibles we use here to follow along with. So we put them back. Okay, we're in John chapter 13, continuing on in John chapter 13. This morning we're going to be in verses 12 through 38. Last week we looked at Jesus. He had washed the feet of his disciples, which was unheard of at that time. Unheard of. The leader washing the feet. They just, you know, usually the leaders are served. It's like that kind of today, isn't it, people in the world, you know, serving. But those of us in the church, we are to serve. If you are in the church, we are to serve one another. And Jesus gave us that example. We looked at that last week in the first 11 verses. He also showed us that we had a need to be washed inside out, to be cleansed of all of our sin. You know, when he gave that example last week, not just the feet, but complete washing by God's word, by Jesus, by the Holy Spirit. And so now, we pick it up in verse 12 of John 13. So when he had washed their feet, and taken his garments and reclined at the table again, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If then the Lord and the teacher washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I gave you an example that you also should do as I did to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a slave is not greater than his master, nor is one who is sent greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." Blessed. We all know the word blessed means happy. Happy are you when you do the things that Jesus gave us to do. To follow his example. That's where true happiness comes from. You can't go out and get happiness. It comes from obeying the Lord. It comes from walking with the Lord. True happiness comes from the Lord. Sure, we get, you know, temporary happiness from the stuff of the Lord, but true happiness comes. And he gave us the example. You will be happy if you do these things. And those of you that have served, those of you have given up your life, and you see people that are blessed, you know that joy. When somebody's life is touched or changed, you're like, wow, you just feel good. The happiness, that good feeling. Wow, look what the Lord has done through me. And that joy in your heart. You know, he gives us a little order here on how these things work. And the first thing is being humble. See, Jesus, number one, humbled himself and came out of eternity and became a man. That is humbling, way beyond what you and I can even imagine. And then, not only that, but his disciples or his followers, he humbles himself and washes their feet. That's the dirty work, man. That's the gross stuff. That's cleaning the toilet. That's the stuff. And he humbled himself and washed their feet to show them how much he loved them. How much he cared for them, as an example of a true Christian ministry, of walking with the Lord, humbling yourself for somebody else. Now, you know, the example there is washing the feet. That doesn't mean you have to go out today and find some people to wash their feet. But in things that you do in your life, considering others is more important than yourself, serving them in different ways, that's the example he's talking about. Not just plain old washing the feet. You know, you go wash somebody's feet and think, well, there, I did that one. What's next? No, you know, it's being that servant in your life. Laying down your life for other people. So, he chose to serve them by doing that. And we're going to see, you know, that it's not all received real well by all of them, but we'll see that in a minute. The second thing is, you know, even with adding in the first 11 verses there, holiness. To be washed. Let him wash our feet every day. Let Jesus wash you every day. By his word. Let him wash Let him cleanse you every day. I don't know about you, but I need it every day. I have to confess my sin every day. I need to be cleansed. I don't, you know, I know you guys, I think probably most of you take a bath or a shower every day. I know you Belizeans do. You guys, you know, you like to be clean. You know, Americans do too, for the most part. Maybe not for your kids. I don't want to take a bath. But you know, you wipe the dirt off you. You want to be clean. Well, you want to be clean on the inside too, by the Spirit. You want to be, not to have clutter in your life. Not to have bad thoughts, you know, and the guilt there all the time. Get cleansed by the Word of God. Right? Let the Lord cleanse you. And then thirdly, happiness is a byproduct of a life that does these things and serves the Lord and walks with the Lord. That's where the happiness will come from. The world thinks happiness is serve me, serve us. That's what the world thinks happiness is. Get the money and make that other people do it. Pay them. They think that's what happiness is, but they're never really happy. And you know you aren't. When you do those kinds of things, you know, for those of you who've been a Christian long enough, that the happiness comes when you're serving other people, you're serving the Lord, and you let the Lord use you. That's happiness. The world is always chasing happiness. But it's like chasing a shadow. You can't ever catch it. As soon as you think you got it, it goes away and you got to do it again. I remember my days of trying to figure it all out, trying to be happy, you know, and one of the paths that I took was drugs. And I could just, it seems like, you know, I always had to keep doing drugs, you know. It wasn't like I could do a drug and then, wow, I've arrived. I never have to do that again. Always had to do more. You know, what the worst drug that I could remember was cocaine. Every time I did cocaine, I had to do more, and had to do more, and had to do more. Before you know, man, all your money's gone, your life's wasted. And you're never happy, and you never arrive, and you never get there. Drugs never get you there. But Jesus gets you there. Every time, and always. And staying in that place. You know what? I'm gonna, just a little sideline on this. For me personally, I'll say, worshiping the Lord. I can't ever really remember worshiping the Lord with my brothers and sisters here, even by myself, and when it was over saying, okay, did that, don't have to do it again. Worship always has left me wanting to do that again with my family, my friends, my brothers and sisters. It should leave you that. It should be, oh, well, that's over with. Don't have to do it again. It should leave you like, wow, that was good. I'm looking forward to doing it again. Of course, you know, I lean in that area because, you know, I was the worship pastor of my church in the States. That was my job, and I mean in that area. And so it's just a great thing. You worship the Lord, and it seems like you're filled, but it's not like you don't ever want to do it again. You want to do it again. But there's still a feeling of happiness and fulfilling when you worship. But when you really worship the Lord in the Spirit, there's a fullness in your heart and in your life. There really is. I know it. Not any different than you. Okay? Happiness. So Jesus always taught them about being humble. He was always teaching them. And now there's an example of that in Matthew chapter 18. If you want to turn here, you can. Hold your place there in John. Because he taught them to be humble. This is a great example. Look at Matthew 18, verse 1. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and said, who then is greatest in the kingdom of heaven? You know, isn't that the way we are in the world? Who's the greatest? Who's the best? Whose team is the best? You know, it's kind of like sports. You know, for us in the States, you know, many of us are in football, you know, and sometimes when our football team wins, we feel like we're better than the other people, like we have anything to do with it, right? You know, or soccer. You know, same bike. You know, when same bike goes out and wins the basketball tournament, or same bike goes out and wins the drumming contest, same bike also feels like they're better than others, right? You know, that's not really true. It just make you better. Not better. We're all the same. But, so Jesus gives this example, and because the disciples are coming, so who's going to be the best? Going to be me? No, it's going to be me. You know, they're looking for that. You know, who's going to sit on the right? Who's going to sit on the left? Who's going to be there? You know, self. Well, verse 2 says, and he called a child to himself and set him before them and said, truly I say to you, unless you are converted and become like children, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. What? What do you mean? You mean, I give my life to Jesus, I'm converted, then I got to walk around and go, goo goo gaga? Or, well, you know, I have no problem with that. I'll tell you, I've always been a kid. Once you know me, you know that. But becoming like a child, what's he talking about here? Then he says, in verse 4, whoever then humbles himself as a child, he is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Be like a child. That doesn't mean act immature. It's not talking about being immature. It's talking about having the faith like a child does. Your children, Maritza, they trust you. They have faith in you. They believe in you. And you're going to take care of them. You know, they're not worried about it. You know, when a little boy or a little girl is with their mom or dad, they're not worried about somebody beating them up. Mom and dad's going to protect them. They have faith in that. And that's how we, like a child, has faith. And even a child, you know, I can go into school there and I can tell these children, say, tell them about Jesus. And they go, yeah, I believe. You know, and they just believe. They have faith to believe. They don't have any doubts. They're not, well, what about this and what about that? And, yeah. Well, I went to school and they say this. You know, they just believe. It's having that kind of a faith, like a child does, simply believing that God is who he said he is, that Jesus did what he said he did for us, and we see in the Word. And putting your faith and your trust like a child would. It's that kind of a thing, okay? And then verse 5, he says, and whoever receives one such child in my name receives me, and whoever causes one of these little ones who believes in me to stumble, it will be better for him to have a heavy millstone hung around his neck and be drowned in the depth of the sea. You know, I believe he's talking about that little child that's standing before him, but I also believe he's talking about you and I, you know, people stumbling us too. We shouldn't stumble one another. Whoever is stumbling, you know, that's not right. That's why we need to be careful in our life, the things that we do, how we walk in this world, so we don't stumble others, especially young believers or children. You can mislead children. Look at children. They'll follow what their parents do. And parent, if you're not walking with Jesus, they're going to follow what you do. It just happens. And that's stumbling. And if you're a believer and you're stumbling your own children, how sad. So watch what we do. You know, help us, Lord. Because I don't know about you, I can't do any of it without Jesus. He has to do it through me. I depend on him totally. I'm just a disaster. Jesus, he does it. Well, now, he teaches them about humility. He teaches them. He's teaching them about serving. But you just can't hear it. You need to do it. You need to put it into your life. You can come here every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, and Wednesday night, and hear the Word of God. You can read the Word of God and go, yeah. But don't do it. It means nothing. Listen, it says in James chapter 1, verse 23 through 25, it says this. For if anyone is a hearer of the Word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks at his natural face in the mirror. For once he has looked at himself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of person he was. But one who looks intently at the perfect law, the law of liberty, and abides by it, not having been a forgetful hearer, but an effectual doer, this man will be blessed in what he does. Not just hearing God's word, but the things you hear, do it. That's where the problem seems to be in our lives. We have a problem doing it. It all sounds good. I remember when I was a younger Christian, and how do you do it? You know, and then I'd fall into something, I had a hard time doing it. But you know what? Once I came to that realization that I couldn't do it, but Jesus could do it through me, all right. So I could surrender myself and take my life and the things of my life, put them in a backseat, and let Jesus do the things. Love people through me. Wash people's feet through me. Pray for people through me. Let him do it. Lord, I can't do it. He can. I mean, how many of you in your flesh can love your enemy? I can't. I don't like them. But Jesus can love them through me. He can love my enemy through me. So I and let them do that. And you know what happens when you do that? All of a sudden, you get love for them, and you care for them. I mean, there's some people I have despised in my life. You know, the Lord nails me. You gotta love them. Oh, man, okay, well, what do I do? Okay, start praying for them. I start praying for them. And every time they would pop up in my mind and the ugly thoughts would come, I would pray for them. And it popped in my mind, the ugly thoughts would come again. I'd pray for them until finally the ugly thoughts quit coming up. And I had a genuine care for them, compassion for them. And it just, by the Spirit of God, He changed me, helped me to love my enemies. He can do that. He doesn't say, go get revenge. In fact, He says, I'll take care of that stuff. We love them. And Jesus is our perfect example of it. Now, this is Jesus' last teaching with the disciples. Very quickly, He's going to be taken away and killed. And this is His last words to them. And so right sandwiched in between this, in the middle of this teaching, two events He's going to talk about. Two different things that are going to happen. He's going to talk about them right now in the middle of this. And He starts there in verse 18. He says this, I do not speak of all of you. I know the ones of John 13, I'm sorry. I do not speak of all of you. I know the ones I have chosen, but it is the scripture that may be fulfilled. He who eats my bread has lifted up his heel against me. And now, from now on, I am telling you before it comes to pass, so that when it does occur, you may believe that I am he. He's going to tell them something that's going to happen. He says, but I'm telling you this so that when it happens, you will believe in me. You will know. You know, if I go tell you future events, you're gonna believe me. That's what He's gonna do. Matter of fact, you know, that's one of the reasons why this Bible is so incredible. There's so many future events that were talked about in the Old Testament that happened when Jesus came and are still happening today that you can't deny it's the truth. You know, I believe, Lord, I know. I see what's happening. I see we're heading for a cashless society. I see that Russia and Iran are gonna attack Israel very soon. I see those things you wrote about thousands of years ago in my life happening. How can I not believe? You know? So that's what He's saying here today. Then He goes on to say, verse 20, truly, truly, I say to you, he who receives whomever I send receives me, and he who receives me receives him who sent me. When Jesus had said this, He became troubled in spirit and testified and said, truly, truly, I say to you that one of you will betray me. This is throw a little shockwave through to the disciples. You know, He says some interesting things here. Hey, if you receive me, you receive the one who sent me. You know, the Father God is the one who sent me. So if you receive Jesus, you receive Him. But then His spirit, He gets troubled. Judas was not a believer. Judas was not one. He was one of the disciples, but he had not really surrendered to the Lord. He didn't really believe in the Lord. So he's the one, obviously, who's going to betray. He was a hypocrite. He never received Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, you know, Jesus loved him so much, and Jesus continued to reach out to him, and Jesus knew that he was going to betray him, and Jesus still loved him, even made him the treasurer when he knew he was stealing the money. The disciples didn't know he was stealing the money. We know it because we read it. But they didn't know it. Troubled in spirit. It's like this. It's like an old friend that you love and you hang with, and he turns his back on you and stabs you in the back. That's why Jesus is troubled. Jesus loved Judas. And he knows he's going to get stabbed in the back. And it hurt him. You know how it is when a friend turns against you? It hurts. This Adonai and some of our best friends turn against us, and it just freaked us out. It crushed us. Could not believe it. People we thought would be our lifetime family. They were our family. So we experienced that firsthand. They were not ready for it. Crushed us. Also, they didn't put walls up and stuff too that we had to break down. Because, you know, they were like this. Best friends turn against you, you're like, well, okay, you don't trust anybody. You know, you get that point, you have to lay that down before the Lord. So you have to feel safe again. Now, here when he says this, he's quoting Psalm 41:9. But David was speaking about a man named Ahithophel. 41:9 is right. He says, he who eats my bread has lifted up his heel against me. He's quoting that psalm. David experienced that. Ahithophel was David's, he was his, not his general, he was the one that devised the war plan. He's the one that told David, here's how to win the battle. Here's how you do it. And he would follow his plans and they would win the battles because of Ahithophel. He was like his right-hand man all his life, it seemed like. David didn't know that Ahithophel obviously had something in his heart against David. Because Ahithophel, when Absalom, David's son, decided to steal the kingdom from his father, Ahithophel went with Absalom and his son and turns back to David. It crushed David. Ahithophel, his man, turned against him. You know, David didn't realize it at the time. You know, and you have to do some studying, you have to do some research. You go, why did he do that? Why did he do that? You want to know why? Because Ahithophel was Bathsheba's grandfather. And Ahithophel knew what David did with Bathsheba and what he did with her husband. And he had that resentment in his heart. And when the time finally came, he was getting his revenge on David. The problem is that God was with David. David was forgiven for those things. Yeah, he suffered a lot of consequences from his sin. But Ahithophel went with Absalom, and guess what Ahithophel did when Absalom would not take his counsel? You know, Ahithophel gave Absalom the right counsel to go and beat David in the battle. He gave him the counsel that would have won, but Absalom listened to his young buddies. He said, no, we're going to do this. Ahithophel went out and hung himself, just like Judas went out and hung himself. Interesting stuff. You start digging into God's word. Now, so he's telling them, one of you will betray me. Then the disciples are freaked out. Verse 22 of John chapter 13, he said, the disciples began looking at one another at a loss to know of which one he was speaking. There was reclining on Jesus' bosom one of the disciples whom Jesus loved. When he says that, he's being kind of humble in spirit. It's actually John. John's lying on the bosom. He says, the one Jesus loved, you know. Himself, I guess, whatever. John's laying there in the bosom. Isn't that cool? Can you just see it? There's Jesus, and this guy's just kind of leaning on him, you know, laying on him. You know, what a blessing. Talk about just a real family situation. Then, he goes on to say, so Simon Peter gestured to him, that's to John, and said to him, tell it is of whom he is speaking. John, ask him who he's talking about, man. We know who he's talking about. And he's going, who's he talking about? Who's going to betray him? You know, they're really at a loss here for this. And then, verse 25, he, leaning back, thus on Jesus' bosom, said to him, Lord, who is it? Jesus then answered, that is the one for whom I shall dip the morsel and give it to him. So when he dipped the morsel, he took it and gave it to Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. After the morsel, Satan then entered into Judas, that is. Therefore, Jesus said to him, what you do, do quickly. Wow. Jesus still loved Judas, and Judas really was his enemy. He reached out to him to the very end. For him to dip the morsel in, hang out with me. He's our church God. He dipped that morsel and gave, that was an honor. Did you know that he was sitting, Judas was, he gave him the place right next to him. He was sitting right next to Jesus the King. He was honoring him. He was reaching out to him even to the last minute by giving him that morsel. And he said, do it quickly. Wow. Talk about love. Judas, I love you. And then Judas kicks him in the face. In a sense. Kicks him in the face. And verse 27 says then, once again, after the morsel, Satan had entered into him. Therefore, Jesus said, do what you do quickly. Now, no one of those reclining at the table knew what purpose he had said this to him. For some were supposing, because Jesus had the money box, that Jesus was saying to him, "Buy the things we have need of for the feast, or else that we should give something to the poor." So after receiving the morsel, he went out immediately, and it was night. Isn't that interesting? That he rejects Jesus, the light, and where does he go? Into the night. Instead of into the light, he's into the darkness. You reject Jesus, you're into the night. In a spiritual sense. The disciples have not got a clue. They think that Jesus had just honored Judas. They don't know what's going on. They never knew that Jesus was not one of them. He wasn't a believer like they were. He wasn't a follower like they were. And he went into the night. Listen, you reject the light, you go into the night. It just happens. But what we see in this here is that Jesus' love is unconditional, right to the very end. He will never give up on you. Never give up on you. He loves you. He loved Judas. And if he loved the man who is going to turn him into the Romans, he can love you, right? If he can love a man named Saul and forgive him for the persecution of the churches who became Paul in the Bible, he can love you. If he can love the man in the late 60s who killed for Charlie Manson and ended up forgiving him when he went to jail and invited Jesus in his heart, he can forgive you and he can love you. No matter what you've done, any one of us, anyone out in the street there, anyone on this peninsula, in this country or in the world, he can forgive. He can forgive Saddam Hussein, who killed a couple hundred thousand of his own people. He would have forgiven Hitler. Some of that stuff we don't understand, we don't even like, but you know what? That's the love of God. So you think of those things, because you know there's many times you run into people say, "I've done too many bad things. How can he forgive me?" Or in your life now, you go, "Look at this bad stuff I'm still doing and I've done. I don't know if I'm worthy. I don't know if he can forgive me." Yes, he does, and yes, he will. He already died on the cross for whatever you've done, you're going to do. Forgive it. Forgive you. That's why I'm up here. I wouldn't be up here if I didn't believe that. What drew me to Jesus was his unconditional love. When I realized that he forgave me, he accepted me the way I was, and he loved me. That's when I started following him. And I realized that kind of love, wow, how can I not follow someone with that kind of love for me? Jesus. Well, that's just to the very end. In verse 31 and 32 of chapter 13. "Therefore, when he had gone out, Jesus said, 'Now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself and will glorify him immediately.'" Jesus' hour has come. The hour that we've been looking at in the first 12 chapters of this book, he said, "My hour has not yet come. My hour has not yet come." The hour has come. It's going to be time. Do what he came to do. And that was to go to a cross for you and I, for him. The sin of the world. It's time to come. I was looking at this morning. I was sitting going over it going, you know, every time I read this part of scripture, when I read the scripture here, it just hits my heart. Jesus had to do that for me. And the reality of it just, you know, heavy on me this morning, what he did. And you know, in the next few chapters, it's going to be like that, you know. What he did for me. His hour is coming. So then he goes on to say, verse 33, "Little children, I am with you a little while longer. You will seek me. And as I said to the Jews, now I also say to you, where I am going, cannot come to. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all men will know that you you are my disciples if you have love for one another. He gives them a new commandment. He gives you and I a new commandment. Love one another. Replace yourself with others. Jesus is going to do that for them, and Jesus did it for us. He took our place on the cross. He took our place for the judgment of sin. He loved us. And you know what? That's a supernatural love. And when you love others like that, it's supernatural. Something that happens to you in the spirit. God does incredible things. Touches people's lives. Changes people's lives. If you and I, as brothers and sisters in Christ, love one another, the people that are walking in the world out there that don't know Christ will know that we are Christians, followers of His, because we love one another. If we don't love one another, it tells me they're not going to know. They won't know. It's an example to the world. So if that's an example, then the worst example is when Christians are fighting, putting each other down, tearing each other up. That's got to be the worst example. Yeah, look at the Christians. They just fight. You know, you hear it all the time. Yeah, look at the Christians. So many different denominations. Yeah, which one is right? They're all fighting amongst each other. You know, that's why here, you know, Catholic, Lutheran, Baptist, Calvary Chapel, whatever it may be, they believe in Jesus Christ, the Bible, those denominations. Hey, we're brothers and sisters in Christ. Now, but when you hear me talk about the Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons, that's because they're not brothers and sisters in Christ. And I just warn you about them to stay away from them, to love on them, but don't accept their false doctrines. But the rest of us, we have some different ways of worshiping in our denominations. It doesn't make one better than another. And some of us, maybe it is a scriptural type of worship, and sometimes we'll have to address that. Say, well, that's not in the Word. But you know what? God bless them. God be with them. You know, that's the thing we want to do. And let's just love them. We don't need to put them down. Let's just love them. And hopefully they do the same towards us. We have our way. You know, we have our way of worship here, right? And we got the guitar. I mean, when we first started out in the ministry years ago, I mean, just before Miss Ann and I started the ministry, most churches only had an organ. We came in with guitars and drums, man. Boy, talk about a wild wind coming into the church. When I took over the music ministry at my church at Truckee in the 1980s, the people were freaked out. Some of them said, no, we can't have them come in because they'll bring drums on the stage and bass guitars. And when we came in, that's what we brought in. They were right. That's how God made us. That's who we were. It was different for them, but it wasn't of the devil like, you know, they didn't seem to think it was. So, you know, we want to love one another. Love your Catholic sister, your Catholic brother. Lutheran, Baptist, Pentecostal, Spanish-speaking, English-speaking. It's lovely. And when we do that, they will know that we are Christians. That's going to draw them. Because, you know, the world already fights. Everybody's fighting all the time. This, that, blah, blah, blah. So why don't we be different than the world? When we fight, we're just like the world. So let's be different. Then Jesus wraps this up. Verse 36 through 30, he says, Simon Peter said to him, Lord, where are you going? Down to 7-Eleven. No, I'm just kidding. Where are you going? Jesus answered, where I go, you cannot follow me now, but you will follow later. Peter said to him, Lord, why can I not follow you right now? I will lay down my life for you. Jesus answered, will you lay your life for me? Truly, truly, I say to you, a rooster will not crow until you deny me three times. Oh, man. Judas is going to betray Jesus. I don't really believe Peter betrayed Jesus. I think he failed him. Because Judas came back. And there's some reasons here why I kind of believe maybe that led Peter to that place of betrayal. I have some reasons now I just want to share with you, right? Number one reason Peter was in this place, he was boasting of himself. He had pride. I will lay my life down for you, Lord. You will not die. Pride, setting stuff up for a fall. Secondly, he argued with the Lord. Lord, you're wrong. You ever done that? Jesus, you're wrong. Remember, Jesus is never wrong. You're wrong. You know, Jesus in Matthew 26, 34 and 35 says this. Jesus said to me, he's talking to Peter, truly I say to you that this very night, before a rooster crows, you will deny me three times. Peter said to him, even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you. All the disciples said the same thing too. Even if I have to die, I won't deny you. You know, if you find yourself arguing with the Lord, you're wrong. Don't argue with the Lord. Lord means you're his. Lord. Okay? Humble yourself and listen. Then thirdly, later that night, Jesus asked him to pray. 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 Be alert. Stay on the alert and pray. And Peter went to sleep. The disciples, when Jesus asked them, they fell asleep. Jesus had to come wake them up. Come on, pray. They fell asleep. Fourthly, Peter followed him at a distance. It says later in Matthew 26, 58, it says, so Peter was following him at a distance as far as the courtyard of the high priest, and he entered in and sat down with officers to see the outcome. When Jesus got taken, he stayed away. Sometimes as Christians, we do that. Yeah, I believe, but I'm not going to go to church. You just got a distant relationship with him. You kind of, you know him, but you know, you don't really follow after him. It's not intimate. It's not close. Then, and the fifth reason is, we'll see later, is he is warmed himself by the enemy's fire. After all this happened, where was he hanging out? He wasn't hanging out with the disciples. He was with the non-believers around the fire. It says in John 18, 18, it says, now the slaves and the officers were standing there, having made a charcoal fire for it was cold, and they were warming themselves, and Peter was also with them, standing and warming himself. He was hanging out with the enemy. Hanging out with the enemy and denying Jesus. You know, when we are, I always tell you, because I believe in my heart, we hang out with is who we become like. And you just see him hang out with those guys, and when they ask him, hey, weren't you with them? Not me, man. Hanging out with the enemy. But in 2 Timothy 2:13, Jesus, Paul speaking by the Holy Spirit says, if we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. Jesus was still faithful to him. The Lord's compassion was on him, even through all this. As a matter of fact, in Luke 22, let me just read it to you. It says, in verse 55, after they had kindled the fire in the courtyard and sat down, Peter was sitting among them, and a servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, looking intently at him, said, this man was with him too. But he denied it, saying, woman, I do not know him. A little later, he saw him and said, you are one of them too. But Peter said, man, I am not. After about an hour had passed, another man began to insist, saying, certainly this man also is with him, for he is a Galilean too. But Peter said, man, I do not know what you're talking about. Immediately, when he was speaking, a rooster crowed, and the Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the word of the Lord he had told him, before a rooster crows today, you will deny me three times. And he went out and bitterly wept. Can you imagine how he had to feel? He just denied him three times. And then their eyes met, man. You saw the eyes of Jesus and the love of Jesus and the compassion of Jesus. Wow. I feel so bad for Peter. That just that impression. But you know, God, Jesus is loving. After Jesus was crucified and he rose from the dead, he told them, he said, go tell Peter and the disciples. Go let Peter know I'm alive, okay? Go tell Peter. Because he knew Peter was crushed and he loved Peter. And then he even went and spoke to Peter and talked to him. Peter, do you love me? Remember that story? We'll get into that later. And the Lord just, he took a little extra special time and compassion towards Peter and personally appeared to him. I know, probably really encouraged him. And you know what? That's how the Lord loves you and the Lord loves me. He's got that kind of compassion for us. No matter what we've done, and turn our back on him, whatever we've done, he still loves us. He still forgives us. He understands each one of us individually, and he has a heart for every one of us. Wow. So kind of a little prophetic thing that he does here that's going to happen very quickly. So what are we to do? We are to grab onto his love. Let his love fill us. Let his love love people through us. Let us love one another. And then, you know what? When we do that, we'll see a difference. We'll see people. Be a little maybe more inquisitive. It's not like you're going to fall over and, hey, I want Jesus in my life right now. But you know what? One at a time. I watch this church get built up by the Holy Spirit, by God, one at a time. Somebody new comes in. Because they've seen somebody's life touched or somebody's life changed. We know we saw that example in the last few weeks. Because I saw somebody's life changed. I wanted to come here and see what was going on. That's what will happen. You just don't know when. Miss Ann and I walked with the Lord for many, many years. We've been walking with the Lord for 15 years when her brother came to us and he said, after 15 years, her brother comes and says, it's really real in your life. It took him 15 years. So don't give up. Don't give up. Let's pray. Lord, you give us so many examples. You show us how to live. And this morning, Father, we ask that you would do that through us. You would help us, Lord. You would remind us. And that we would surrender our hearts and our lives. Lord, we would listen to your word, but we would put it into our lives. And maybe even today start showing a little bit more love to those who are believers in the family of Christ. And Lord, your word would then come to truth, that people would know that you are, we are Christians, and that you are truly who you say you are. So Father, have your way in our hearts and in our lives, and use us in our communities, wherever we're at, Lord, to shine your light and to love people. Thank you, Lord, that that is your heart, and we surrender even now to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.